this unknown comes out of nowhere to lead the pack at Augusta. He's on his final hole. The crowd is standing on his feet here at Augusta. The normally reserved Augusta crowd going wild.
British, probably should say Firestone with that one.
Come out of nowhere.
Joe, you know that movie, right? Caddyshack, right?
It's a must.
Everybody has to. You know, Caddyshack. Golf Digest actually said that's the number one golf movie of all time.
Oh, my gosh. Really?
It tells you that there hasn't been a lot of golf.
No. It's up there with Animal House.
I like Tin Cup myself.
Tin Cup was pretty good.
Bagger Vance is pretty good.
Yeah.
There was one that told the story of Bobby Jones. It may have been the Bobby Jones story. I don't know.
Huh.
But I thought that one was really good, too.
Man,
I think they did it in black and white.
You are a multi-talented guy. You're into so many different things. You know your movie's good, too, when I listen.
I try.
Good, man.
Okay, so you wanted to talk a little bit about this hand injury?
There's a unique injury, hand injury, and it's been the injury of the year for the Rubber Ducks, and I made it over last night to the Rubber Ducks game. Beautiful night. Of course, we had an eye on the Tribe, a lot of fans were asking about this because it came out in the paper last week. The Ducks have had three guys have an injury called a hook of the hamate fracture. And most notably is this kid who is supposed to be a prospect by the name of Greg Allen. He missed about 3 months.
They like him a lot.
Yeah, I saw him last night. He's got wheels and a good center fielder. But he missed about 3 months with this injury. And it happens in our office not infrequently, so I want to mention it. It is missed very, very frequently because it's hard to pick up. So this bone in the fleshy part of your hand, the opposite of where the thumb is, the fleshy part of the hand, has kind of a hook to it, this bone. It's called the hook of the hamate. And in sports, where you use a club or a bat or a racket, you pound against this bone, and it gets fractured at times. And people just have continuous, persistent pain to start with, and then they lose their grip strength. They can't hold on to the bat or the club after a period of time. They get a fracture to it, a stress-type fracture. Sometimes there's one mechanism of something they do that brings it on. The books all say that you get it from gripping the bat. In my career in baseball, I've also gotten a lot of baseball kids diving head first, and they hit that fleshy part of their thumb, and they just can't get rid of this pain and then weakness gripping the bat. We do a gripping strength. And a lot of people just call it, oh, it's a muscle pull. Even on traditional x-ray, it doesn't show up, so it's missed very frequently. You have to do a special x-ray or even a limited study CAT scan to pick up this hook and see if it's broken. And if it's broken and it doesn't heal well, it's just not going to get better until you take it out. But the medical people have to have a high index of suspicion. They have to be aware that there is a bone there. And so this bone really troubles people in those sports where you have a club, a racket. And now, one other thing about the hook is there's a nerve that rides underneath it, part of the radial nerve. So what happens also is people that go on these cross-country bike trips and they're gripping the handlebars forever, they come back and they say, gosh, my hand's been numb for 3 weeks, 6 weeks, and I know immediately by phone what it is. They have a thing called handlebar palsy where this hook of the hamate compresses this nerve and their hand is numb and weak. They have kind of a claw hand. Handlebar palsy, hook of the hamate fracture. Three Rubber Ducks have had it this year. A lot of times, and I remember even Tommy in the 96 or 97 season wearing a big donut pad all through the remainder of the season. And then at the end of the year at that level, usually they just have a very simple surgery afterwards to take that bone off. They go on their way. Obviously, he hit how many ever other home runs after that, so it didn't stop his career. And Greg Allen had an excision, but it means taken off. But he ended up missing 3 months, and he's just getting his legs under him, so to speak. He looked really good last night. But this hook of the hamate fracture, even with young kids that you see, if they keep saying, man, I'm having pain on the fleshy part, opposite the thumb, get them to a doc that knows the special x-rays that need to be done because they may have a hook of the hamate. If you pick it up early and you get some rest out of the kid, it can heal. If they have to keep playing and they play through it, it usually breaks through all the way and we end up needing surgery. So a hook of the hamate fracture is just kind of a unique, it's not rare, it's a little uncommon, but not rare. But like I said, three Rubber Ducks in 1 year have had that injury this year. Yeah.
Hey, yesterday, August 1st, started fall practices for all the fall sports teams, you know, soccer, cross country, football, lacrosse, all these sports out there practicing right now. Pretty high heat, upper 80s and everything.
Yeah,
thought you'd send out some caution, parents, coaches, everybody. Make sure you take note of it, that high heat can be dangerous.
No doubt. We had notes out to our athletic trainers. We're up to this fall 26 athletic trainers in a lot of schools in the area. We're covering everybody in the city series, and those kids a lot of times haven't had access to trainers. The trainers are out there. They have their pools and their ice and their cool water ready to dunk kids in there if they're starting to go through that progression from heat exhaustion to heat stroke. We cannot see heat stroke. It is a life-threatening. A kid in Battle Creek, some city in Michigan last week, passed away. Mm. It's preventable. We have to be ready out there. So the trainers and the coaches even and the people on the sidelines need to know that when this first week is the biggest risk, when kids are getting out there and they're not really acclimatized to it. So I just kind of hold my breath these first 2 weeks, make sure the trainers are very aware of it. I was out at training camp yesterday at Hoban, very hot out there, no doubt about it. And although the kids have been working in June and May, it's a different kind of heat in August, like you said. And so hydration is important. At times we have to remember, we don't want to see that thing hyponatremia. Some kids just hydrating with water can get into problems. So at times we need to kind of mix it in with some rehydrating solution with some sodium in there too. But our trainers are so good, and they're very aware of this, and they do a good job, and we're ready for it, and it's here.
Joe, educate us, parents, grandparents, guardians, and such. Kids come home from a heavy workout in the heat. I mean, obviously water, you know, maybe some sports drinks, some fruits and vegetables. What would you recommend to get these kids? And then maybe warning signs that we have a little problem.
Yeah, we have to be aware of this days in advance. So you have to do things like daily weights, twice a day, I actually like. And you'll see as kids get to 2 to 3 to 4% dehydrated, you'll see their weight go down after each practice. They got to get that back up. They got to drink enough to get their weight back. So daily weights are important. Watching the color of your urine when it's getting really dark yellow, that is a sign that you're getting very dehydrated. We ask kids, most of our locker rooms have pictures with the colors, and if your urine is this color, this dark, you better talk to somebody about that. Looking at the weights. So those are some pretty decent signs. Cramping, when we're starting to get into cramping a little bit, when we're starting to get into the excessive sweating. And remember, people don't like to take temperatures, but we have to do that. We have the thermometers ready, even the rectal thermometers. If somebody's going into heat stroke, when they're getting up, you know, in the range of 100, 102, 104, the body's mechanism of dealing with heat stops. And that's when heat stroke is. The body turns off its mechanism of dealing with heat stroke. And we lose kids every single year that go into heat stroke. So we need to be able to pick this up early. And some of those techniques I talked about, like daily weights, like making sure if they're cramping. Like one other thing, Ray, and we talk about it all the time, make sure of if they're sick, hold them out of practice, because if they're, you know, having diarrhea or having upper viral respiratory infections, if they're on meds that may dehydrate them, they shouldn't be taking the caffeinated beverages, the energy drinks. They shouldn't be taking the supplements that dehydrate them. Many of them are taking anti-inflammatories for pain because they have muscle aches and pain when they start hitting people and running a lot. You got to be careful. All of those things can add to the dehydration effect.
Great stuff, Joe. Thanks for coming in this week.
Okay, Ray. Have a great week.
You too. Thanks. Dr. Joe Congeni, Sports Medicine Center and Akron Children's Hospital. He joins us Wednesdays at this time.